So, of course, we have to talk about the Ballad of the Fallen Angels moment. So let's bring out the devil himself, Vicious, played by the brilliant Alex Hassell. Hey!
This feels very vicious.
Where Alex likes to be.
Slightly shut out.
Why are you
looming
behind us?
He's at the kids' table. Yeah. Oh my gosh, yeah. The moment we get the shot. I remember seeing in the trailer, seeing that moment, and oh my gosh.
It's cool to see it like this matched up against it, right? Apparently this was an anime first, is that right?
Yeah, that's what they said.
Oh, I see.
But, you know, in the cartoon, we really don't get that much of Vicious.
No,
we get
that's right.
so much more of his relationship with Spike in the TV show. What was it like having that whole dynamic come to a head in this scene?
That looks good.
That does it really
cool,
doesn't it?
It looks great.
Well, it was particularly fun because, as John and the others have said, we did so much fight training together. To get to bring that to bear with John was really, really good fun to sort of put that and be head to head with each other, right?
Yeah, we really had a rhythm going, especially during that fight, I felt.
Yeah.
What was it like having to hit those marks? You have to do a lot of training. What was the training like?
We did do a lot of training, but actually that came together quite quickly, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. The good thing about having a lot of previs and knowing what you were doing, you were quoting stuff and all of that, was you knew what you were supposed to be doing. There's no, let's vibe this out. You know, someone's sitting there with an iPad and going, okay, this is the shot we're doing.
The way we wanted to be in some frame buys that were one-to-ones with the anime, where we really were just like lens it, frame it, light it, move in it like the anime. This is our moment to really pay tribute.
So, André, please talk us through a little bit about recreating this, really, we keep saying the word iconic, but it's so iconic. Can you talk me through a little bit of this?
It did feel like that the end of season one wanted to find its apex in borrowing from this episode. That was important because it felt like in building a true showdown, we needed to put them in the cathedral. And it became a real question of like how, where. We were in New Zealand. There are no Gothic cathedrals in New Zealand. There are a lot of modern churches in New Zealand, but we needed a true Gothic cathedral to recreate this. So we built it. We built it from the ground up on a soundstage in, as John was saying earlier, one of the most massive builds I've ever been a part of. It was a combination of a build and green screen, and there were so many elements that went into it. We had so much previs built on this scene before we actually ever shot a frame of it. For me, it's funny to see the final product and to see where it all began, but I lived with the middle piece. This is what we're doing. This is how we're going to do it. These are our cartoon stick figures that we're making for what all the shots are going to be. So it's amazing to see this on both ends like lined up this way. But that was the endeavor. It had to come down to a showdown between Spike and Vicious.
Yeah, we could talk about this forever, and we will actually, but first, if you did not pay attention to the spoiler alert message earlier, we are now entering into endgame territory. So this is your last chance to head out while you still can. Here's a quick refresher on where we left things in the ending. Vicious kidnaps Kimmy and the Bebop crew set out to rescue her. Spike and Vicious have an intense final showdown in the cathedral. Julia arrives, shoots Vicious and Spike, and decides to take over the syndicate herself. Faye makes the decision to leave the crew, find out more about her past. Jet cuts ties with Spike, and just as he's about to fall unconscious, Spike is found by Ed, Radical Edward, together with Ayn. All right, well, I don't think anybody saw that ending coming. I certainly didn't. But we cannot discuss it without the essential role of Julia, played by the wonderful Elena Satine. Welcome, Elena!
Hi. I think I got pranked. I was told we were coming in costume.
this is everybody. This is everybody's casual cosplay. But to state the obvious, things in the series did not go the same as in the anime. The big twist with Julia taking over the syndicate, it was so wild for me, a fan who's like, I know how this ends. I didn't. But are you most excited for Julia?
It was just so much fun to unpack the character because in the anime, I'm a huge fan of the anime. I have been for over a decade, but you know, in the anime, her story is told largely off screen. So to be able to take her on this journey from this, you know, terrified caged bird to a woman who finds her strength and then, you know, uses her savvy to navigate into this, you know, badass position of power. It was like really satisfying to do.
For John, what was Spike thinking being shot by this woman he loved, by the dream that he was chasing this entire time?
What was happening when he was being shot by Julia was he was thinking, this is a bummer. No, I guess Julia is his reason for living and for existing, and now that's been severed. And I don't know what season two is going to bring for him, because there isn't... This is an extraordinarily low point for him. I mean, he's gone through a lot, but there's always been a reason to get up. And I don't know that he has that reason to get up right now.
By the end of the season, the Bebop crew is broken up entirely, which is so heartbreaking, especially since just before that, we got the scene with Faye's birthday. So where is Faye going for now? Like, what can you tell us about that?
If you look at where she found that poster, and then she was on her computer using the futuristic GPS technology to verify and pinpoint where that was.
Enhance.
Yeah. I think that's where it's headed.
So André, there were a lot of clues in the last episode about things that could be blueprints for season two. One of the big ones being the introduction of Edward Wong Howe Pipilu Trotsky the IV.
Yes, all we wanted was for Ed to make an appearance on Cowboy Bebop. You know, Ed doesn't show up until the 9th episode of the anime. So it wasn't like Ed is a core member of the Bebop crew from Gate in the anime. And it was important to spend enough time with these characters in order to really understand them and get traction. And as much as Faye Valentine is a disruptor, which she is, Ed is a massive disruptor. And there needed to be some stability amongst who these people were before we could introduce this other sort of wild and crazy component into the show. And, you know, that radical Ed is always something wild and kooky and getting the gang into trouble, so.
Before we go, though, I do want to say that Ed name-dropped the butterfly man, Vincent Villaggio, in the last episode, who is, as fans know, the villain from Knocking on Heaven's Door, the Cowboy Bebop movie. You gotta give me a little something here, André.
I think I'm getting a call from the Netflix folks about... no, look, we, as I said, Ed will get our gang into a lot of trouble, as she's known to do. So they just might be up against some pretty terrifying people in season two.
Hey, Buckaroos, liked what you just saw? Make sure to check out the full episode of Cowboy Bebop Unlocked, the official Netflix Geeked after show.